Right now, I'm in one of the many microclimates in my yard. By understanding microclimates, you give yourself an advantage in choosing where to put your plants and how to grow your plants. So join me as I give you some information to help you understand microclimates. I'm Gardener Scott. To best understand microclimates, I think it's important that we better understand what climate is and what weather is. Now, weather are the particular conditions at a particular location at a particular time. For me, right now, it's overcast. It's cloudy. Occasionally, the sun comes through. I'm expecting rain later on. And that's what determines weather. It's those conditions. It's the temperature. It's the wind. It's the humidity. It's the presence of precipitation. All of those things are how we define weather. Now, climate takes each individual day of weather and averages them over a period of many years. Wikipedia suggests that that time period is 30 years. Whatever the time frame, we're talking about an average condition over a long period of time. Weather changes, usually on a day-to-day basis, here in Colorado by a minute-to-minute basis. My weather has already gone through changes today, and there are more changes to come. But the climate stays relatively consistent. So even though I might have rain this afternoon, my climate is very hot and dry in the summer. It's also very cold and dry in the winter. That's the climate. Even though during some of the days of the winter, our weather might bring snow, and in the summer, it might bring rain. Climate generally refers to a large area. We can say that the climate is different at the equator than the North or South Pole. We can say that the climate is different in the United States than it is in India. The climate is different between Colorado and Texas. Within Colorado, the climate is different between Colorado Springs and Grand Junction. And you can get down to a point where we begin talking about microclimates. And microclimates are the same general effect that we see in a large area climate, but in a much smaller location. Microclimates can be city size. All of the snow that Buffalo, New York gets in the winter comes from the Great Lakes and the lake effect. Those super hot days that Phoenix, Arizona gets in the summer is from the heat island effect with all the asphalt and concrete. And when you bring it down to the level that's best for us gardeners to understand within our own garden, we might only be talking about a space, a microclimate, that is 2 feet by 2 feet. Understanding those small spaces within our garden and landscape can dramatically affect how successful we are in growing plants. So what makes this spot a microclimate? Well, it's actually two completely different microclimates depending on the time of year. And it really comes down to this plant, this big chokecherry. In the summer, all of these leaves completely protect this area. It's cooler and it's shadier underneath this shrub, which influences what kind of plants can grow here. But in the winter, all of these leaves fall. The sun is coming from that direction, the south. It now reflects off of this building, which is on the north. So this area actually has the opposite effect in the winter. It's warmer than the surrounding area because of that reflective heat. And it's protected from some of those winter winds by both the plant and this building. So let's start identifying some of those things that can change the weather within our own landscape and garden. And the first is buildings. I'm standing on the north side of this shed. That means it doesn't get much sun during the bulk of the day, and it gets the full force of the north winds in the winter. Now I'm standing on the south side of the shed. It gets full sun during the summer. It doesn't get any of those northerly winds in the winter. This building has different microclimates depending on whether you're on the south side or the north side. So the shed helps identify for us the number one factor in determining microclimates, and that's the sun and its effect on our garden. It's different from the north side to the south side, and that's primarily a light factor. We want our plants to have light, so we avoid structures that will block that light because the structure has created a microclimate. The other factor when the sun is in play is the heat. Now, the air temperature stays relatively consistent all around us. It feels warmer in the sun, but that's just because of the radiation beating down on us. A thermometer reading in the shade and a thermometer reading in the sun, if you protect it from that radiation, will show that the air temperature stays pretty consistent. Where the heat changes, however, is when you have a structure that reflects and absorbs some of that radiation and that heat. So the south side of a building, well, the soil kind of gets a double dose of radiation. It's got the sun warming the soil, but then it also has the sunlight that's bouncing off of that building to even increase that soil temperature more. So structures play a role not just in the light, but the warmth development from the sun. What makes this a microclimate? Well, I'm facing due south. So the area I'm standing in gets full sun during the day, and it gets this reflective heat during the day as well. In addition, there is a rock mulch on the ground, and the rocks will actually absorb and hold some of that energy. So any plants growing in this area need to be able to handle a lot of sun and a lot of heat. Houses and sheds are the most obvious structures that create their own microclimates. But anything that affects that localized weather in a small spot, like a fence or a pergola, they can also affect the microclimates. You don't have much control over those structures once they're in place. You can think about creating microclimates when putting in a fence or any other type of structure. But once they're in, your control is pretty much lost. You do have control over another important microclimate creator, and that's plants, like this big tree. All the way down to small plants, they can create microclimates. You can see that with the grass growing in my front yard. Now, I recently moved into this house, and we've had a lot of rain this spring and early summer, so the sprinkler system hasn't been turned on yet. But on the north side of the tree, it's a lot of green grass that is growing pretty well. But if you move to the south side of the tree, you see no grass at all, because it's in full sun all day long. And that shaded area received enough water to keep this cool season grass alive. But the full sun area obviously didn't. So there's a different microclimate from one side of the tree to the other side of the tree. And understanding that allows me now to choose the right plant for this location based on which side of the tree it's on. It also gives me that knowledge base so that in the future I can make my own microclimates with trees or large shrubs or any other plant down to a size of a single bed. It's within individual beds that we often see dramatic effects of microclimates but don't understand what's happening. These peonies on the right are about to reach full bloom, while these peonies on the left have just started to bud. They're not really blooming at all. What causes this? Well, the plants on the right get full sun in the morning and early afternoon, while these plants on the left actually get shade from that tree for more than 2 hours before the other plant starts getting shade. That's something that I recommend all gardeners do when they notice a problem with their plants. Approach it from a microclimate perspective. Why is one plant doing well when the same plant just a couple feet away isn't? It could be they've got different microclimates. I like using blocks and stones in my perennial beds. They'll absorb the sun's energy during the day and then release it at night, warming the beds in spring and fall, which is important for a region like mine. You can see this effect very dramatically in the winter after a snow. Look for how the snow melts first around rocks in your landscape. When you begin to recognize those localized effects, those microclimates within your garden, you can begin to use them to your advantage and actually create microclimates to allow you to grow plants you might not otherwise be able to grow. That brings me back to this microclimate. We get so much sun that I can't grow plants that require shade. But by recognizing an area of my garden that gets full shade during the hot summer months, well, I could grow some shade plants underneath this big shrub to add some variety to my garden. My garden is in USDA Zone 5B. That limits some of what I can grow. But on the south side of this shed, with full sun, reflective heat, and the blocking of the north winter winds, I can almost guarantee you the microclimate right here is easily Zone 6. That means I could grow some of those Mediterranean plants that might have difficulty in other areas of the garden. Anything that modifies those weather factors that determine climate can ultimately create microclimates. And that's what to look for in your garden. All of those components. Humidity, for example. I live in a very dry region with very low humidity. But near a fountain or a waterfall in my garden, I can grow plants that require higher humidity. What do you have in your garden? What are your microclimates? Or are there microclimates you'd like to create? Let me know. I'd like to hear that. If you have any other comments or questions, you can let me know those below as well. If you'd like to see more of these gardening videos, well then subscribe to the Gardener Scott channel if you haven't already done so. And if you like this video, you can give me a thumbs up and share it. I'm Gardener Scott. Enjoy gardening.